Our lecture today is about neural networks, a family of algorithms that try to mimic how the brain functions. As we have seen before, our brain is a network of neurons, and each neuron is connected to between tens and tens of thousands of other neurons that communicate between them. Okay, so some information is being transferred from one neuron to another one. This family of algorithms works extremely well on several applications, and these include handwritten character recognition, such as digit on a zip code on an envelope, spoken words, faces, and so on and so forth, just to cite a few. It has been a topic of research that was extensively studied in the 80s and 90s, but had some moderate success at the time. Now it's back with lots of successes in using deep learning, thanks to algorithmic and computational progress that we have been witnessing since the 90s. As you recall, the first algorithm, or the simplest neural network, is called the perceptron, invented by Rosenblatt in 1959. We have seen this in the previous lecture. As you recall, the perceptron is a gross simplification of the functioning of real neuron. So the idea is that given some inputs, the neuron should produce some output. The input is taken from all the neurons, and the output is dispatched to the other neurons. So similarly, a perceptron would take values that are actually the feature values in a table that are a table of the training examples, for example. So suppose this is one of the examples. This is the example I. This example I, we have feature values xi1, xi2, xid, assuming they are d dimensions. We're going to introduce xi0, which is actually the bias. Remember, when we do the weighted sum, we're going to do w0 plus w1 x1 plus w2 x2, etc. So this first value here has an x of 1. So I'm going to put an xi0 of 1. Then these values are weighted, are put into a weighted sum of the values. That would be the sum of over all the dimensions of wj, xij. So all the dimensions j for the feature I, we are going to do this weighted sum of the values. So this weight has to be learned. We don't know them a priori. This weighted sum is then plugged into some squashing function that actually will tell us whether the output or the label of the example I is either plus 1 or minus 1. So we're going to use here in the different kinds of squashing function we could use. One of them is called the step function, which is this one, step function, or threshold function, that actually takes the weighted sum and then compares it to 0. If the weighted sum is bigger than 0, then it declares that the function is 1 and minus 1 otherwise. So which means they're going to try to find, the learning here is to try to find the ways that will actually match the input to the output. So you're going to learn, so as you balance, you have for the example of the input, the right output. So the weights has to be learned by training this perceptron. So the function, again, is a function that takes the sign of the weighted sum of the feature values by the vector w, which is actually the weights of the that are the arrows between the neurons as input and the neuron that does the sum of the feature values. One point that emerged from our lecture on perceptron is how expressive are perceptrons. So if we consider, for example, the perceptrons with the step function, just like the example we saw now, the idea of finding the perceptron is to adopt an iterative method that will start with a random hyperplane and tweak it with the using the training data until we find the separating hyperplane. So this is good enough to represent lots of functions, and this include Boolean functions like the AND, the OR. Here there's a typo, it should be the not OR, the not AND, etc. But it is not able to actually separate the data that looks like an XOR. It just produces a linear separator of the input space. So suppose we have two feature values, x1, x2, that could take either 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. We are going to express x1 and x2 as a value that is equal to 1 only when both values are equal to 1, 0 otherwise. X1 or x2 would be equal to 1 everywhere except when they're both equal to 0. And x1, let's do the XOR, which would be actually equal to 1 only when they are differing by their difference. So the rest would be equal to 0. So if you want to find the hyperplane that separates the data in this for these four points, so we will have to draw x1, x2 on this plane. And then we could represent the points that are zero as for 0, 0, it's zero. For 0, 1, it's also zero and zero here. And we would have another positive point right here. So as we said, it's easy to find this separating hyperplane that actually separate the data into two. Same thing would happen with the or, in which we would have data that looks like this. X1, X2. In this case, everything would be actually 1 except for 0, 0. This point here would be a negative point or 0. And the hyperplane in this case would be this line that separates the positive side from the negative side. So the positive side would be this on this side. And finally, in the XOR example, we're going to see that it's not possible to separate this with the hyperplane. So we have X1 equal to plus equal 1, or in both cases where we have one of them is equal to, one of the features equal to 1, the zeros would be on both sides, and it's not possible to find one line that separates this data. However, but we can still separate it with two lines if we draw, for example, a line here and the line here. All this area in the middle will be plus, this area will be, so the plus will be down, and the everything in here would be negative, and everything in here would be negative. Okay, so we need in this case two hyperplane instead of one hyperplane. So the perceptron can be extended to what we call a multilayer perceptron, in which the multilayer perceptron will exploit the ability of the perceptrons to represent simple function. But then we're going to combine them together to make a more complicated network of different layers of those elementary questions. So however, if we take a cascade of linear function, the result is still linear, and we want to be able to actually represent high nonlinear functions. So for example, if we have data that looks like this, so with the, remember, with points like here as negative and the points around positive and the points around as negative, it's very hard to find really several hyperplane that would separate this data, the positive from the negative point. So we need to find something that would allow us to really represent those highly nonlinear functions. Also, the perceptron is using a threshold function which is undifferentiable and not suitable for gradient descent in case data is not linearly separable. We want a function whose output is a linear function of the input. One possibility is to use what we call the sigmoid function, that is g of z, ez divided by 1 plus ez, or equivalently 1 divided by 1 plus e minus z. This function has this shape here, in which we have actually the interesting property, it's called also called the S function, right? It's shaped like an S. And this function has the interesting property that it will be converging to 1 whenever z goes to plus infinity, and converging to 0 whenever z goes to minus infinity. So this value would continue toward when z goes to minus infinity is 0, when z goes plus infinity, it converges to 1. Okay, so I'm going to use this function to show that we can represent actually the XOR function. So now we're given a new look to our perceptron, in which case we still have our weighted sum of the values. But in this case, we're going to use this, what we call the activation function, is no longer the step function. In this case, it's the sigmoid function. And this will be the g of what? Of the weighted sum of the values. So we're not doing this step function anymore. And f of xi in this case will be equal to 1 divided by 1 plus e minus z. Our z is xi, which is the weighted sum of the values. So our f of xi would be simply 1 divided by 1 plus e of minus the weighted sum of the feature values. Okay, so we keep everything the same, but our activation function here is a new squashing function, which is the sigmoid function.